Hello, humans. One of my haters who has stalked me for a little while now, he actually asked me a good question. So I'm going to treat his question as if it were a genuine question from a genuine seeker of truth. He asked me, "Do you really think there is anyone in the U.S. who hasn't heard the message?" Well, let's play out this question logically. So let's assume you're right. Let's pretend that as of right now, all people in America have heard the gospel. So what? Critics of Christianity often leap from an argument to an unjustified conclusion. This is called the non sequitur fallacy. The conclusion simply doesn't follow. So even if all people have heard the gospel message, it simply doesn't follow that they understand it, and it most certainly doesn't follow that they live out the message that they heard or even think they understand. It also doesn't follow that they heard the true gospel message. They might have heard the counterfeit version, for example, which states that people can sin as much as they want because Jesus died for our sins. That's simply not true. That's not what the gospel says. Further, even if all people have heard the true gospel as of right now, well, how many people are not of the age of accountability today who will be the age of accountability tomorrow? However, I can personally guarantee you by my own experience that in the divided states of America, which is saturated in sin and wokeness, many people have not heard the true gospel message. Ponder on this. How many atheist parents intentionally keep their children away from the gospel due to their hatred of the gospel? How many Muslims living in America have either never heard the gospel at all or have only heard the lies their Muslim parents have told them about Christianity? Now, Peter, even you, who claims to know the gospel, even you often get it wrong, and then I have to correct you because you present a straw man fallacy. Now, for those listening who don't know what that means, the fallacy of straw man is changing or exaggerating an opponent's position in order to make it easier to refute. Even those who have heard the gospel can still misunderstand the true gospel. And so, critics often create distorted and untrue versions of what the Bible says, and then they attack their distorted and misrepresented versions, but they lack understanding. Consider the following examples here from street ministry.
Historical figure?
I don't know.
I think he was just a person. I don't know.
Just a normal person, like us.
He was a selfless person.
I have no clue. He was a man.
I don't read the Bible.
Not really.
I'm Muslim, so I read the Quran, so I do not read the Bible.
I don't personally read the Bible.
I've read parts of the Bible.
It really has nothing to do with me.
I was never raised reading the Bible. My mom's pagan and my dad's non-denominational.
I've never read the Bible in my entire life. I've never had to.
And so there are many people who do not know who Christ Jesus is. Moreover, many people have never even read the Bible for themselves. And again, even if they have read the Bible on a surface level, many people lack integrity in their investigative skills, and then they intentionally take scripture out of proper context in order to create straw man fallacies. Therefore, even if all people in the U.S. have heard the gospel as of right now, I know beyond any doubt that there are many people who do not understand the true gospel. If they did, they would gladly accept the truth of the good news over the lies of this wicked world. Nobody willingly lives out a lie if they know the truth. Now, for this reason, it is written in Romans 10:14, "For then, how will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? How will they hear without a preacher?" Hi, I'm that preacher. So, whoever is watching and listening to this video right now, I'm going to share with you the true gospel message. That way you do not accept a different and wrong gospel. Now, the word gospel is the English translation of the Greek word euangelion, which means a good announcement, a declaration of good news. So, what is this good news? I mean, well, we can't really know what the good news is without first knowing what the bad news is. So, what's the bad news? The bad news began when Adam and Eve freely chose to disobey God, partook of the forbidden fruit, which they were commanded not to eat, and then they came to know evil from good, and then they were separated from God due to sin. And through one man, sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned. Thus, the bad news is that we are all sinners deserving of judgment for our sins against a holy God. Our sin has kept us from His presence and eternal life. No one can earn his or her way into the presence of God because there is no one righteous. Even our best efforts of righteous deeds seem like filthy rags in comparison to God's holiness. There is no way to earn our way back into eternal life with the Lord and in His kingdom. It's a debt we're simply unable to pay. In our fallen, sinful nature, we're incapable of living sinless lives. However, the good news is that God, who is the Word, tabernacled in flesh, dwelt among us in order to live a sinless life and become the perfect sacrifice for us on our behalf so that we will be in right standing with the Lord once again. Jesus is Emmanuel, which means God with us. And He did what we could never do in order to redeem us and restore right relationship. The good news is that salvation is as easy as placing our faith in the finished work of Christ Jesus, confessing that He died for our sins and resurrected as it is written. And our faith in Christ is what saves us. It's simple, and that's why it's good news. Listen, God loved us so much that He allowed us to fail through our freedom of choice so that after we failed by our own efforts, He came to the rescue like a good father, took our place on death row, and then set us free. Not only did He set us free from the slavery of sin and the sentence of death, but He adopted us as His children, and He is going to allow us to live in His kingdom. Now, but of course, listen, the gospel can only truly be summarized in a scenario in which it is shared with a person who does not yet know or believe. There are many details to the gospel that can only be learned through dedicated study of God's word or divine revelation. Like, for example, only study of scripture can now reveal how Christ Jesus fulfilled ancient prophecies of the coming Messiah who would save His people. And the fact that there would be a Messiah who would deliver His people, that was good news to the ancient Israelites. Listen, to learn more about fulfilled prophecies, see my published article, Prophecy as Proof of Precision. But listen, here now comes the time when you learn why I have been sent to preach. So Jesus in John 15:22, regarding His reason for preaching, He said, "If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have sin, but now they have no excuse for their sin." Likewise, Acts 17:30-31, Paul, speaking to the men of Athens, said, "Therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent, because He has fixed a day in which He will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom He has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising Him from the dead." And so, likewise, you have now heard the true gospel message from me, and so you also are without excuse. No longer are you able to claim ignorance to what the true gospel message actually is. So you're now at a crossroad. Will you investigate with integrity the truth of God's word, or will you, by presuppositions and worldly bias, reject truth just because you don't like what it says? Regardless of what you choose by your own free will, I have now eliminated the excuse of ignorance. You know. And now that you know, you need to make a choice. Listen, do you want help investigating? Do you need resources? Do you have questions due to doubts? If you need help, myself and others are able and available to help you. And so, look, that's another excuse eliminated. You don't have to do this alone. You're not alone in this. So let's eliminate excuses and seek solutions. And if you're ready to accept Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior, let me know so we can celebrate with you. And if you're nearby, I'll even baptize you myself. So seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you. God desires a genuine relationship with you. Will you seek?